Let's sing this together. Oh, come.
Oh, come, oh, come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appears. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the gloomy clouds of night, in death's dark shadows put to flight. Come, thou King of David, come, redeeming now our earthly home. Make safe the way that leads on high, and close the path of misery. Shall come to thee, O Israel. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
You're here with us, Emmanuel. You're here with us, Emmanuel. You are here. You're here with us, Emmanuel. You're here with us, oh, Emmanuel. You're here with us, Emmanuel. You're here with us, you are, Emmanuel. You're here with us,
I know it's true,
Emmanuel. You're here with us.
Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel has come to thee,
Yes, Jesus, Emmanuel, you have come, and you're here with us now, so we rejoice. We sing your praise.
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature sing, and heaven and nature sing, and
Advent is a season in the Christian church where the church prepares and expectantly waits for the celebration of Christ's coming. It's a season of longing and anticipation where we remember the longing and anticipation that Israel felt, and it's the longing and anticipation the church now feels as we wait for Christ's return. Yet the remarkable thing, at least I think so, about this season of Advent is that it culminates in the remembrance and celebration of Christ's human birth. The culmination of Advent is what we call the incarnation, the wondrous assertion that God became a human. God became flesh. And despite our culture's now comfortability with the birth narrative of Jesus, I think that incarnation is just as countercultural today as it was when the church first professed it. You see, the incarnation is the proclamation that God is willing to take on human limitation. Despite our culture's obsession with trying to use technology to overcome our human limitation, God willingly enters into it. God takes on the form of human flesh, doubling down on this creation, saying he will restore all things, saying he's not given up on it, not given up on us. So this Christmas, we proclaim and say, rejoice, rejoice to the world, because God has come. There is hope. There is peace. There is joy. Because God is Emmanuel. God is with us, our wonderful counselor. So let's sing this together with Laura. Let's proclaim, wonderful counselor, Prince of Peace.
You are the medicine. Only cure for everything I fear within. Redeeming what was lost in all that could have been. All this is a healing kind of love. You are the truest friend, staying through the night.
Stand.
everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Emmanuel, God with us, you here with me. Wonderful Counselor, the government is resting on your shoulders. An everlasting Father, Prince of Peace, Emmanuel, God with us, you're here with me. Wonderful Counselor, the government is resting on your shoulders.
For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders, and he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, and the Prince of Peace. Of the increase of his government and peace, there will be no end. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Good to be with you today. Thank you, team, for leading us in worship. If you're a guest with us today, whether you're in this room for the first time or if you're a guest with us online, we're so glad that you decided to join us at Whittier Area Community Church today. For those of you online, our chat hosts would love to connect with you and give you a link to a gift. And if you're on campus, we want to invite you to a spot just inside our lobby called Guest Central, where there's a team there that has a gift for you as well. We want to help you get better connected, answer any questions that you have about our community. Hopefully when you came in today, you got one of these little cards here that says Christmas. If you didn't get one, they'll be on the tables as you leave, and there's some ways that you can get this if you're online as well. But this is for you, and it's also kind of not for you. It's kind of for you, but sort of not for you, because hopefully you'll get this and then you'll give it away to someone as a way to invite someone to join us at one of our Christmas services. We've got a service on Thursday, December 23rd at 7 p.m., and then three services on Friday, December 24th at 3 p.m., 5 p.m., and 7 p.m. If someone in your family, if you're friends with someone that is primarily a Spanish-speaking person, we want to invite them at 7 p.m. on both of those evenings, because we'll have Spanish translation for that as well. But hopefully you'll join us for Christmas at WACC. It's going to be filled with exciting music. We're going to light candles and sing Silent Night together. So it should be a wonderful couple of evenings together. Wanted to talk through the schedule for next Sunday. There's going to be a slight change to our schedule next week. We'll have the Heritage at 8, 9:30, and 11 a.m. But during our 5 p.m. service, our team here is going to be beginning to prepare for our services in the midweek. So we're going to start our rehearsals next week around 4 or 5 p.m. And so we won't have the 5 p.m. service. So hopefully you'll join us in the morning that day. We'll be right back at it on December 26th with our whole line of services. Hopefully you'll join us the day after Christmas as well. And we want to invite you to not just come and be a part of the service, but also to serve with us. You can serve as one of our ushers and greeters. By the way, they say thank you to the team that greets us when we came in today. Thank you to our ushers and greeters. We got to get all the candles set. We want to make this an inviting and a wonderful place for our guests to come and worship Jesus together. So hopefully you can sign up for that on our website. And then we know that this season can be difficult for a lot of different reasons. But we got a program tomorrow evening called Surviving the Holidays. And want to invite you to that. That's going to be in room B203. Building B is the where our kids meet on Sunday mornings. It's right over there, I think. And second level of that building, if you know someone that needs encouragement, join us from 6 to 8 tomorrow evening for Surviving the Holidays. Last week, my friend Christian kind of walked through some ways that we want to celebrate how God has been working as we have this mission to gather and worship, to grow in community, and to go and serve our world. And today, I get to celebrate some of the ways that we've seen God working through our Grow ministry. We had 1,986 people engaged in small group communities. Anybody in a small group? I'm in a small group. Raise your hand if you're in a group. 107 people joined a group for the very first time, which I think is awesome. Just over 400 kids and leaders were active in VBS. Does anybody know what VBS stands for? Vacation Bible School, fun summer camp that we did for kids. And if there's anything to celebrate, it's this right here, right? Kids, 63 kids made a first-time decision to follow Jesus this summer. And the angels are rejoicing in heaven. We had almost 400 high school and junior high students engaged in small group communities, and 139 kids and students, including my two kids, experienced summer camp. I know that summer camp had a huge impact on my life growing up, and such a wonderful time. So thank you for being a church that just doesn't gather on Sunday, but grows in groups, and then we go and we serve each other in this world together. Amen. Each year we take a special offering at Christmas time, and this is usually an outreach offering where we try to care for vulnerable situations both locally in our world. And we've got our Wonder Christmas offering. We're going to be supporting valuable at-risk youth in our community, and I want to invite you to be a part of that. And there's a few ways you can do that. There's these pink envelopes which should be all over the room today. Hopefully you got one when you came in. And you can turn this offering envelope in. You can just check that Christmas offering box that says Wonder. You can also do this online or through our app. But just a couple other ways I want to celebrate and highlight that you can give a year-end gift is through our general fund. The general fund just goes to support the ongoing ministry of the church. It's paying for those restrooms to get clean. It's paying for this microphone to be heard right now, and the lights that are on and the air, all that stuff. Just the normal operation of the church is what gets supported through the general fund. Our Like Never Before offering goes to pay the mortgage for this building, the revamped kids center that we've just launched. You can continue to give there, a staff Christmas gift, and then Where Needed Most, which is a strategic fund that our church board uses to fund projects, and wherever they see a need, they're able to support that through Where Needed Most. But just a few ways that you can support and give your gift to God this Christmas. But let's pray together. Heavenly Father, King of Kings, You are so generous and so good to us. And in the midst of all the busyness of Christmas, the finding of presents and the wrapping of gifts, would we unwrap in our own hearts just how wonderful You are, how good You've been to each and every one of us. And God, would the first fruits of our gifts this Christmas lay at Your feet, God. And we thank You for Your Spirit who guides us. We thank You for the redemption we have through Jesus. God, You are truly wonderful. Bless these offerings in the name of Your Son, we pray. All of us said, amen. Amen. Hey, in just a second, Sarah is going to lead us in a song. But I just wanted to congratulate Sarah. She's graduating from Biola this Friday. So congratulations. Sarah's been an intern with us through Biola over the last few months, and it's just been such a blessing to have you lead me and for you to lead us in worship. She is going to be moving back to the Central Coast, back to her home church, and this is her last Sunday with us. But I just wanted to say thank you, and she's going to lead us now in probably one of the most popular modern Christmas songs written in the last 30 years. This is called Mary, Did You Know?
Mary, did you know that your baby boy would one day on water? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our souls? sons and daughters. Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? This child that you delivered will soon deliver you. Did you know that your baby boy will give sight to a blind man? Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Did you know that your baby boy has walked where angels draw? When you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh Mary, did you? Sing how the blind will see. The blind will see, the deaf will hear, and the dead will live again. The lame will leap, the dumb will speak, the praises of the Lamb. The blind will see, and the deaf will hear, the dead.
Over 3,000 years ago, a man named Gideon asked a question that I think people have been asking centuries since. If the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? Where are all his wonders that our ancestors told us about? You see, it's been 3,000 years since Gideon asked that question, but I think so many of us still wonder that same thing. If the Lord is with us, why has all this happened to us? I think if we're honest, at times in life, we all experience some unexpected or painful circumstance, and we begin to wonder this. Like Gideon, we've heard of God's great wonders, and we've known God shows up in really big ways, but we wonder why in this circumstance doesn't seem like he's not doing it. If the Lord is with us, why has this happened to us? Or if God loves us, why has this happened to us? Or if God has a plan, where is he right now? And I bring this question up today because I think as we are heading into Christmas, I think this is really a natural time for that question to surface. Maybe you've never asked yourself the question out loud, but maybe beneath the surface, especially during this time of year where there's so many expectations of here's what life's going to look like at Christmas, or here's what family's going to look like at Christmas. This is a question that comes up. Especially last week we said, this is the time where people sing about this being the most wonderful time of the year. This is the time where you see all the Christmas commercials where everybody is acting jolly and feeling merry and getting new Lexuses, you know, I mean. And for most of us, that's really not our circumstances. And so we kind of wonder, God, if you're with us, why are we going through this? And I want to suggest to you today, if you open up and you study the story of Christmas in the beginning, people were probably asking that same question there as well, because the first Christmas wasn't wrapped in bows and new cars. Instead, we find out first Christmas came in a world full of exploitation and people who were experiencing occupation, and for a couple who was experiencing relational stress and complication. And friends, people were asking those same questions that first Christmas. And yet on that first Christmas, God still met them in the midst of their questions, and he showed the wonder of his love to them. Last week we said, there is no place so low that God won't go so you can experience the wonder of his love. And I think there is no question that is too bold or scary for God to meet you in with the wonder of his love. And today I want to help you understand what the wonder of God's love does. It has the power to turn your if and your questions into a because. And we're going to be turning to a passage of scripture today that demonstrates that. And if I could sum up this passage today for you, here's kind of just the big summary, the big idea of today if you're taking notes. Even when painful and confusing events occur, the plan has not changed for your counselor. If you have your Bible, turn with me right now to Isaiah chapter 9, where you will discover that you have a counselor who has an unchanging plan. And this passage today assures us of this, no matter what events happen in your life. As you turn into Isaiah chapter 9, I want to just kind of let you know this, what we're about to read, were words given to the people of Israel during a time that was terrifying, where they had a lot of questions. It was a time when they were on the edge of an imminent national disaster, where there was going to be complete devastation because the Assyrian army was going to come in from the north. And when they would come in, they would desecrate cities, they would kill people, they would exile all the cream of the crop from that country. And it would have looked like a wasteland after Assyria came in. Isaiah chapter 8 tells us that this is what's ahead: distress, darkness, fearful gloom, utter darkness. That's what the people of Israel are feeling in that moment. And I don't know if you were watching the news this past week, but you can kind of imagine what was it like to be a country maybe in an unstable situation and then all of a sudden knowing that there could be an impending attack. This past week was reading and watching about how there's this possibility of a foreign invasion to the country of Ukraine. And there's lots of soldiers from another army at their border right now. And people are questioning, what would that be like if suddenly in the weeks ahead, this nation was invaded? And this is already a nation since 2014, where there's been over 10,000 civilian casualties, 1.5 million displaced people in Ukraine. There's lots, like a heavy situation that you can pray for. But I think that situation pales in comparison to what Israel was about to face, because Israel was going to face a foreign invasion where there would be complete annihilation. People, their whole cities were going to be torn apart, and burn down. That was kind of the policy for the Assyrians. You come in, you kill, destroy, and burn everything that's left. Many of the cities would look like a wasteland. And yet, Isaiah chapter 9 gives that there's this hope that God can still do wonders in a wasteland. And he does it by turning the people's attention to what he's going to do 700 years later. Look at Isaiah chapter 9. Let's look at these words together. Nevertheless, and that first word tells you that there always still will be hope, that darkness doesn't get the end of the story. Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. In the past, God humbled the land of Zebulun and the land of Naphtali, but in the future, he will honor Galilee of the nations by the way of the sea beyond the Jordan. And then these familiar words. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of the dark, deep darkness, a light has dawned. You have enlarged the nation and increased their joy. They rejoice before you, God, as people rejoice at the harvest, as warriors rejoice when dividing plunder. For as in the day of Midian's defeat, you have shattered the yoke that burdens them, the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor. Every warrior's boot used in battle and every garment rolled in blood will be destined for burning, will be fuel for the fire. And we're going to pause there before we get to verse 6, because I just want to unpack just those first couple verses for you. There's a promise here. Before we get to what the promises are, I want you to notice just a couple interesting things about the text itself. If you're looking at this in your Bible or even in your phone, you notice that the way that the text is justified changes from verse 1 to verse 2. And the reason you see these indentations is it's going from just prose to suddenly poetry. Verse 2 on tells a poetic vision of what God's going to do in the future. And I think the form is pointing us to the beauty of the hope of what God's going to do. So it changes in structure. The other thing that changes is the tense. Did you catch that? Even though this is a prophecy for 700 years forward from that moment, did you notice it's written in past tense? Which is really strange that all of a sudden it says that already a light has dawned, but this is in the future. You have enlarged the nation. You have increased the joy. Past tense, future occurrence. It goes on and says, you know, you've shattered the yoke that burdens them. Why in the world is the writer using past tense if this is talking about something 700 years in the future? And here's what commentators suggest, and I agree, is from God's perspective, this promise is as good as done. The people could be that confident in the certainty of the wonders that are stated. And so then, what is the prophecy that is stated with such certainty? Here's the promise, that against the backdrop of darkness and despair and questions in a wasteland, a dawn is coming. A new day is planned. And when this new day comes, here's what's promised. There will be the light of salvation unlike ever seen before. There will be increased joy for God's people that is going to create liberation from oppressors. And then the last one is, and there will be an ending of all warfare. Those are big promises to make, and to put them in past tense as certain, that's really bold. So how is God going to bring about this new day with salvation, increased joy, liberation, and the ending of all wars? And you get to verse 6 and you see it's through a plan no one would have ever expected. Verse 6, for to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be on his shoulders. According to Isaiah, liberation and joy and the end of all wars is coming through the birth of a child, through the gift of a son. I mean, a child is the solution to all of our greatest problems in the world. A son is the answer to all of the questions we wrestle with in dark times. Who would have ever thought of that? And yet, it shouldn't surprise us, because what you read at the end of verse 6 answers why this is. I love what Ray Ortland says, one pastor. He says, God's answer to everything that has ever terrorized us is a child. The power of God is so far superior to the Assyrians and to all the big shots of the world that he can defeat them by coming as a mere child. His answer to the bullies swaggering through history is not to become an even bigger bully. His answer is Jesus, the gift of a child. And the world thinking that a child would be the greatest wonder that would ever happen, it seems surprising, but it shouldn't be surprising when you notice who the child is. Verse 6. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given. And then it says this, he will be called, four titles, Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. And the one phrase I want to camp on just for the last couple moments I have with you right there is that phrase, Wonderful Counselor. You see, in that title, I think we did discover a truth that can transform your if into a because. A truth that is so powerful that it will give you, I think, sturdy anchor no matter what difficulty you face. Wonderful Counselor, let me just unpack this for you, comes from two Hebrew words, Pele and Ya'atz. And we've often grown accustomed to singing those words about a Wonderful Counselor, translated in English, Wonderful Counselor. But another way you could translate this that I think brings a better communication of what's happening here is a wonder of a counselor. You see, sometimes in English, we use wonderful as like, that's a really good thing. But this is not talking about just a really good thing. This is talking about an incomprehensible thing, a thing that leaves you speechless, that leaves you saying, wow. Another way scholars say to put this is that he is a counselor of wonders. He is a counselor who does incomprehensible things that leave you speechless. But I need to unpack this a little bit more, because when you and I, a lot of times, when we read that he's a counselor of wonders, we in our English cultural perspective sometimes go to a therapist of wonders. Like, I have a really good counselor. He does wonders. I mean, this is not talking about a therapist. This is not talking about a psychologist. Here's what it's talking about. He is a strategist. He is a strategist. Remember in the ancient world that a counselor was someone who would guide a king. A counselor's job was to plan tactics, to catch enemies by surprise, to protect his people, to triumph over his adversaries. And friends, this is exactly what our God does. Our God is a counselor of wonders, and God is an amazing strategist, and he's worked out all these plans to surprise the enemy and to save you, his people, and to defeat evil once and for all. And the scriptures, they point to the truth of this over and over again. Look at Proverbs 21:30. There is no wisdom, no insight, no plan that can succeed against the Lord. Isaiah 14:27, the Lord Almighty has spoken, who can change his plans? When his hand moves, who can stop him? Proverbs 19:21, many are the plans in a person's heart, but it is the Lord's purpose that prevails. And Isaiah 46:11, what I have said, God says, that I will bring about. What I have planned, that I will do. Friends, God is a counselor who can pull off whatever he plans to do. And the prime example of this is that first Christmas where God shares, I am going to bring joy and peace, and I'm gonna make suffering come to an end, and it's all gonna come through a child. Now, this past week, I was thinking, that's an amazing plan, number one, that he could come up with, but it's also amazing to me that it could be foretold 700 years before it actually happened. Again, Isaiah's writing about the 700 years before Jesus shows up on the scene and is born. What's even more amazing, though, is if you look throughout the Old Testament, and there are prophecies about Jesus coming even before 700 years, and there's more than just that one in Isaiah. One Hebrew scholar, Walt Kaiser, says this, there are at least 65 unique, clear, and personal prophecies about Jesus in the Old Testament that he fulfills in the New Testament. And other scholars, I know some of you are like, no, there's more than that, John. Some scholars say there are 200 to 500 if you count some that are repeated and some that are more inferences. And friends, this points to how much of a wonder of a counselor you have. Let me walk you through a few of these. I know you can't take notes on everything I'm about to write, but I just want you just to take this in. Number one, the first prophecy, the Messiah will be born in Bethlehem. This is promised in Micah 5. It's fulfilled in Matthew 2, John 7, and Luke 2. Now, I know some of you, that's like wallpaper seeing that, because you're like, I've heard that my whole life. Imagine with me, though, that I came to you and said, hey, there's going to be this really important future leader, and he's going to be born in the future, and I want you to guess where he's going to be born, and he's going to be born in the year 2721. Go. I mean, we would have no idea. Where in the world am I going to pick 700 years later? That is what happens with that prophecy. Secondly, the Messiah will be preceded by a transformative messenger. That's John the Baptist, promised in Isaiah 40, Malachi 3, fulfilled in Matthew 3, Matthew 11, John 1, Luke chapter 1. Number 3, the Messiah will enter Jerusalem on a donkey, promised in Zechariah 9, fulfilled in Matthew 21, John 12, on Palm Sunday. Number 4, the Messiah will be betrayed by a friend. Judas did that, remember? Promised in Psalm 41 and Psalm 55, fulfilled in Matthew 10, Matthew 26, and John chapter 13. Number 5, the Messiah will be sold for 30 pieces of silver, promised in Zechariah 11, fulfilled in Matthew 26 and Matthew 27. Number 6, the money that the Messiah is sold with will be thrown to the potter in the house of God. This one's like even trippier. Promised in Zechariah 11, fulfilled in Matthew 27. The Messiah will be born to a virgin, promised in Isaiah 7, fulfilled in Matthew chapter 1 and Luke chapter 1. Number 8, the Messiah will be hated without cause, promised in Isaiah 49, Psalm 69, fulfilled, Jesus explains, at John 15. Number 9, the Messiah will be silent before his accusers, promised in Isaiah 53, fulfilled in Matthew 27. The Messiah will be executed by crucifixion by having his hands and feet pierced, promised in Psalm 22, fulfilled in Matthew 27, Mark 15, John 19. Pause with me on this one real quick. What is the likelihood if I said, hey, there's going to be this great religious leader who's going to die in the future? Guess how he dies. And you're like, okay, John, how far in the future? 3021. Let's take it 1,000 years in the future. Guess how he dies. Oh, by the way, they haven't even invented the way he's going to be killed yet. Are you kidding me? And this is what David did 1,000 years before Jesus, hundreds of years before crucifixion was even used as an instrument of death. The way Jesus died was foretold. Number 11, the Messiah will be given vinegar to quench his thirst, promised in Psalm 69, fulfilled in Matthew 27, Mark 14, Luke 23, John 19. Number 12, the Messiah will be executed without the breaking of bones, foreshadowed in Exodus 12, which is really cool, promised in Psalm 34, fulfilled in John 19. Number 13, the Messiah will be buried among the rich, promised in Isaiah 53, fulfilled in Matthew 27. Number 14, the Messiah will be executed by crucifixion between thieves, promised in Isaiah 53, Psalm 22, fulfilled in Matthew 27, Mark 15, Luke 23. Number 15, the Messiah will be raised from the dead, promised in Isaiah 53 and Psalm 16, fulfilled in Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, you pick your, you know, whatever. And the last one, I mean, the last one's worth like the weight of all the others, right? Andy Stanley says, when somebody predicts their own death and resurrection and pulls it off, we should go with whatever that person says. But looking at all the prophecies, you got to admit, man, it's as if somebody planned this. It's as if all of like this whole Old Testament is pointing to this one life. And this is what Jesus told the religious leaders. He said, you diligently study the scriptures because you think that by them you possess eternal life. These are the scriptures that testify about me. I am how you find eternal life, Jesus says. And friends, how does this all fit together so well? It's because your God is a counselor of wonders, a strategist who can carry out a plan across centuries, a strategist who knows how do I balance free human will and dumb human mistakes with this overarching redemptive plan. Friends, this is not predictions about the future. This is plans for the future. It was Corey Ten Boom who once said this, God does not have problems, only plans. And only a counselor of wonders can pull off a plan like this. And here, friends, is what this means for your life, I believe. I think it means this. Even when painful and confusing events occur, the plan has not changed for your wonderful counselor. God's plan is still strong and still stable in your life today. Now, I know some of you might be thinking, John, not so fast. What if Jesus arranged these circumstances so it looked like he fulfilled all those Old Testament prophecies? I mean, John, Jesus could have read in Zechariah about the Messiah riding a donkey, and Jesus says, let's pick a donkey instead of a horse. I mean, couldn't he have arranged these things to look like the Messiah? And I'd say you probably have a point on the donkey one, but how does he arrange some of these other things? Like, how did he arrange to be born into a family where both parents were in the lineage of King David? How do you pull that one off? Or how do you arrange for your birth parents to make sure you're born in a city that's foretold that's actually not the city that they live in? Or how do you arrange how that your own death is gonna be done specifically by crucifixion when you've never committed a crime? And then how do you arrange to have the executioners at your crucifixion gamble over your garment, which happened in John chapter 19 and was foretold 1,000 years earlier in Psalm chapter 22? How do you arrange to have the executioners not break your legs like they break everybody else's legs? And more importantly, how do you arrange to come back from the dead when you've been killed and then you show up with all those people who watched you actually die? Friends, it may seem possible that maybe you could fake one or two of those prophecies, but to pull off all of them would be impossible. You have a wonder of a counselor behind these. Now, again, I know some of you are thinking, John, okay, I hear you on some of those, but what if this is just all a coincidence? And I want to just take this rabbit trail for a couple moments with you, because I think there are some of you who you're wondering, maybe this whole universe is just a coincidence. Maybe it's by accident. Maybe there is no overarching plan. And so let me just talk to you for a couple minutes about a branch of mathematics called probability. Now, probability, some of you know, is a branch of mathematics that helps determine how likely it is for a proposition to be true or for an event to take place. And so I want to take that idea of probability and put it to Jesus and ask, what is the probability that Jesus of Nazareth could fulfill so many prophecies? And if you've ever wondered this before, you don't have to wonder anymore, because there was a professor of science and mathematics from Westmont College named Peter Stoner who actually did the research and ran the equations. He ended up working with 12 of his different university courses made up of 600 university students on this one project, and their goal was to carefully weigh all of the factors behind the prophecies Jesus fulfilled and to find out what's the probability that he, this one man, Jesus of Nazareth, could fulfill them. So the 600 students actually didn't start by just saying, okay, we have this many prophecies. They actually started going through the prophecies and saying, well, there could be a reason someone would want to fake this one. Or there could be a donkey available for someone to fake this one. So they don't start with 65. They brought it down until even the most skeptical students in the class said, yeah, that one seems solid. And so they brought a smaller amount to Stoner, and Stoner said, your amount of prophecies is too big. Let's limit it down to 8. What are the odds that the life of Jesus of Nazareth could fulfill 8 of the Old Testament prophecies? So the classes ran the numbers, and Stoner worked with the numbers. And after they finished running all the numbers and calculations, they ended up sending them to a committee of the American Science Affiliation so that they could verify that the calculations were dependable and accurate in regard to the scientific and mathematic material. For example, let me show you how they did one of these. So they said, what is the likelihood that Micah could predict that Jesus would be born in Bethlehem? Micah 5:2 predicts that. And so what they did is they determined what was the estimated average population of Bethlehem from the time of Micah to the time of Jesus. And then they divided that average population, divided it by the average population of the earth estimated at that time. And so they concluded the chance of this one man fulfilling that one prophecy would be 1 in 300,000. So they examined that one. They examined all 8. And they asked, what are the odds that the life of Jesus could fulfill 8 of the Old Testament prophecies? And the answer was 1 in 10 to the 17th power, which is actually this. It is called 1 in 100 quadrillion. To illustrate, my mind had a hard time getting around how big this was. So to illustrate this, Stoner gave this analogy. He said this. He said, if you had 10 tickets and you marked one of those 10 tickets, put them in a hat, stirred it up, and blindfolded a friend and said, I want you to pick the ticket out of the hat that I marked, your friend would have a 1 in 10 chance of finding that one marked ticket. To get to 1 in 100 quadrillion, here's what you would need to do instead. You need to take 100 quadrillion silver dollars, and you need to go to the entire state of Texas and spread them out over the entire surface area of Texas. I drove through Texas recently. That's a big state, okay? So not only will 100 quadrillion silver dollars cover the entire state of Texas, but because there are so many of them, they will be 2 feet high all over the state of Texas. Now, find one of those silver dollars, mark it, hide it, and then stir up all of those so it's somewhere in that mix. Blindfold a friend, set him loose all over the state of Texas, tell him he can go anywhere he wants, but he has to find that one coin in the 100 quadrillion. Friends, the chance of a person being able to fulfill 8 of those prophecies is the same as that person finding that one marked silver dollar. Friends, to the time that Jesus lived, this is, seems improbable, right? But it's only 8 prophecies here. I mean, if any of you who are in financial investment, if I told you, hey, this is a really good investment, you have a 1 in 100 quadrillion chance of getting a return, I mean, you would never go for that. But again, that's just 8 prophecies. I think I'd make a case there are at least 65. So here's what Stoner did. Stoner said, well, let's up the numbers. Let's say 48. Still conservative, but Jesus fulfills 48 prophecies from the Old Testament. 48 prophecies fulfilled. What's the chance of that? 1 in 10 to the 157th power. Here's what that one looks like. It's a number none of you will ever have to deal with in math class. And here's why. Because science tells us that number is actually greater than the number of electrons in the visible universe. Okay, electrons, remember, are a subatomic particle. They're small part of an atom, which means, here's what this means. You have a better chance of finding one electron in the universe that's selected out of all the other electrons than for this one man, Jesus of Nazareth, to fulfill these 48 prophecies. And again, there are probably 65 at least. Why do I spend so much time belaboring this point? Because I want you to know these prophecies are not lucky predictions and they're not happenstance. They are demonstrations that God has a plan. And if this plan is certain and true over thousands of years in the past, you can be sure this plan is solid and certain in your life this Christmas. Friends, your life is no exception. Even when painful and confusing events occur, which they do, the plan has not changed for your counselor. Your counselor is a counselor. He does wonders. He works out plans in ways that will surprise the enemy and save his people, save you, and triumph over evil. And friends, God is doing that in this time. Another time, Israel was in a really dark situation. Another prophet stepped forward, and he gave them these words from God that are true for you today. I know the plans I have for you. They're solid. They're certain. You can put them in the past tense if you want. Plans to prosper you, not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. And nothing can stop that future. Because again, God is a counselor of wonders. You never have to worry. Is God going to lose track of things though? Did I wander too far this time? Are circumstances too messed up? Friends, God never says to himself some of the things we say to ourselves. God never says to himself, something just occurred to me. He never says to himself, if only I thought of that before. He never says, I didn't see that one coming. He never says, I guess I need to hurry this up. What does God say again? God says, what I've said, I will bring about. What I have planned, that I will do. And friends, you can find confidence in that this Christmas. Even though the backdrop of your story might feel gloomy and dark right now, God's plan to bring good and defeat evil in your life is certain. Recently, I was listening and watching a friend of mine who this past year has faced some very difficult challenges. And as he's going into Christmas this year, circumstances do not look anything like what he would have anticipated they would look like. And yet he's still praying, and yet he's still trusting. And he recently shared the prayer that he's been trusting God with, And he said, this is the prayer I can pray with honesty right now, and I want to share this with you. Here's what he said. God, I have no idea what you're doing, but I trust you. He said, that is the strongest, most honest prayer that I can pray right now. God, I have no idea how you're going to work this situation as part of your plan, but I believe you'll do it. And I wonder if some of you this Christmas, that's the prayer you need to pray. I have no idea what you're doing, God, but I trust you. I trust that you're a wonder of a counselor. And so even if your timing doesn't match up with my schedule, and even if your answers don't match my expectation, and even if my perspective doesn't line up with your perspective, I choose to trust you. And let me tell you again, when you trust this, when you trust God like that, let me tell you what it does. It has the power to turn your if into a because. Because instead of praying like Gideon, if the Lord is with us, why has this happened? You start praying, because the Lord is with us, why has this happened? Instead of praying, if God loves me, why did he allow this? You start praying, because God loves me, why did he allow this? Instead of, if God has a plan, why am I facing this? You start saying, because God has a plan, why am I facing this? And that shifts your questions and transforms them from desolation that all might be lost into anticipation that God still has good ahead. Even when painful and confusing events occur, the plan has not changed for your counselor. Would you pray with me? God, I thank you that our lives are not just left to our own mistakes, our blunders, that you are a great counselor and you are working out a plan to save us and to make all things new. And God, we still live with that expectation that Jesus came, but he will come again. And when he comes again, it will be the ending of all wars and the restoration of all things. But in the midst of that this Christmas, God, I pray you would bring peace to my friends who are hurting and who are questioning and wondering. And just with your head bowed and your eyes closed, this has been a season where you have a lot of questions and you're not sure what to pray. Maybe you just pray that prayer my friend prayed. God, I don't understand what you're doing, but I trust you. I trust that you sent your son, Jesus, to save me from my sins. You sent Jesus to be the Prince of Peace who will free this world from evil. I trust you that you have a plan for my life still. So I give you my life and ask you, use it for your purpose. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen. Amen. Well, friends, thank you so much for joining us here today. As you're leaving, if you need prayer, we have a team who will be up here and would love to pray for you. And if you are online, we would love to pray for you there as well. God bless you and have a good week.